Hello and welcome to Money Control. My name is Ashwin Mohan, and today we have a very exciting conversation lined up for you. 2021 has been a blockbuster year for M&A activity in India, and it's come during a challenging time for corporates because of COVID-19, of course. Now, we have seen the birth of more than 40 unicorns. We have seen a lot of aggression from private equity funds, sealing controlled transactions, edging out their strategic counterparts. And of course, we've seen a lot of action in the digital space, which is booming currently as we speak. Not to mention, of course, the record amount of money that was raised in the equity capital markets via the IPO route. Bain & Company has come out with their India M&A report, and joining us today for a quick chat is Karan Singh, the managing partner at Bain & Company's India offices. Karan, thank you so much for taking our time and welcome to Money Control.
Thank you, Ashwin. Nice to chat with you.
Right, Karan. So what we're going to try and do is we're going to try and look at some of the major themes that have emerged from your report. And we're also trying, we're also going to try and crystal ball gaze into what could be expected in 2022 after the action-packed year that we have seen on the M&A front this year. So for starters, Karan, your report speaks about how COVID-19 has accelerated disruption as far as Indian corporates are concerned. Now, Karan, if one way to link that disruption to deal-making, fundamentally, what in your opinion has been the core behavioral change, or so to say, the change in the DNA of Indian corporates when it comes to M&A activity during the pandemic phase and, of course, even post it? And here I'm referring to both the old economy companies as well as, you know, some of the new age companies. So what do you think fundamentally shifted?
That's a good question, Ashwin. I think there's probably two things I'd call out. One, I'm seeing incredible boldness in terms of a reset of ambition and aspiration from the key decision makers, the CEOs, the boards. And the second one I would call out is a tremendous appetite for growth and the opportunity for transformation that is available. So those are the two underlying driving factors. The third one that you did mention is a tremendous superabundance of capital or capital availability or currencies that's enabling people to use for deal making. But those are the three underlying drivers for why we're seeing this incredible momentum in the M&A space.
So another very interesting theme that has emerged from your report is, you know, the rapid emergence or the gradual emergence of scope deals. And these are deals which are transformative deals, which involve acquisitions outside the core area of business of a particular company. Now, this is, of course, in contrast to scale deals that might be aimed solely at growth. Now, Karan, your report says that, you know, this pocket of new age deals accounts for more than 4 out of 10 transactions, especially in the digital space and the renewable transaction space during the time period that the report has covered. Now, there are also digital insurgents. We have the likes of Byju's. They've been on an unbelievable acquisition spree. We have the likes of Poyo. They've looked at acquiring companies abroad. Back home, we have PharmEasy. Now, all these companies, all these digital insurgents are looking at newer geographies. They're looking at plugging any gaps in their current portfolio. And then also looking at the omni-channel route. And that's something that, of course, PharmEasy did with the ThyroCare acquisition that sort of, you know, shook up the entire market. Do you expect this kind of trend to also play out aggressively in 2022? And if yes, which specific set or subset of digital and tech companies do you see, the same kind of acquisitive, aggression being demonstrated going ahead?
Ashwin, both the trends you referred to in terms of the rise of scope deals or the increased momentum of scope deals and the insurgents continuing to be acquisitive, I think will continue. I think we started to see this shift. I think the momentum is very much in the favor of both those mega trends. Scope deals are happening because people are looking at engine 2 opportunities. People are looking at capability expansion opportunities. And I think we are all recognizing the number of opportunities to expand business boundaries is very substantial. So this is an active area of corporate strategy where people are looking at, you know, redefining business boundaries, redefining business definition. And that's one big driver of scope deals. The second driver of scope deals, why we think this will continue, are people are acquiring new capabilities. They do not have many of the capabilities that are critical for success going forward. I think we all would accept that there has been a huge fillip when it comes to the adoption of technology. And there is very good rationale for accessing technology from the external bases. So those will continue. On the insurgent side, I think they are extremely well capitalized. We are seeing many of the insurgent deals. People are using their currency, which is we all recognize are richly valued, or they're doing cash, and we know they're pretty well funded. But more than that, the underlying driver is there are opportunities for scale. There are opportunities for business expansion. Engine 2, where we're looking at new geographies or expanding the business boundaries, similar to the scope deals I just mentioned. And so I think the insurgent trend towards using M&A to dramatically grow or aggressively grow, we think will continue. So I think both those trends probably will be here for the next 12 to 18 months at least.
Right. So 2022 can also expect similar action. That's the word coming in. Karan, you'll agree with me when I say that, you know, perhaps private equity funds, they were the real superstars of, you know, the last year or so. Gone are the days when private equity funds would only stop at a minority stake. We have seen several case studies across sectors wherein you have private equity funds who are sealing control deals, you know, buying a strategic stake, taking control of the operations of a particular company, and in many cases, you know, edging out some of the strategic counterparts. And when I say private equity funds, I'm also extending the bucket to include sovereign wealth funds and you know, some of the pension funds, especially from Canada. Now, that's been the trend that has been noticed in terms of aggression. In fact, your report highlights that PE and VC activity has seen a 2x and a 3x spike respectively in H1 2021 versus H1 2020. Now, the question is, going ahead, Karan, which are the sectors, which are the hottest sectors where you see PE funds continuing to pour in money? And of course, they've got a lot of gunpowder. So what do you think will be the focus of these PE funds? If you could highlight a few top sectors for us.
No, sure, Ashwin. I think the financial investors are sitting on a significant amount of dry powder. And I think if you go back in time and look at investments made during times of turbulence, and the same thing actually applies to corporate India as well. I think during times of turbulence are crucibles of opportunity, and M&A is a lever people have used. If you look at the GFC, the last the global financial crisis, the deal returns of people who made the right deals at the right time during the times of turbulence, or if you look at corporate India, that actually actively did M&A, strategic M&A at that time. Corporate India of those deals was about 2x delta from an EBIT basis 5 years later. So I think the right deals done during times of turbulence can have a pretty significant payoff. So I think the financial investors are sitting on a lot of dry powder. It's probably a record amount of dry powder that they have raised and they continue to raise. And they're deploying it quite aggressively as they're seeing opportunities. But I think you made a very good point. I think we are starting to see control deals. We're starting to see roll-ups in multiple sectors. And you're starting to see a focus on multiple areas that are driving the Indian economy or the level of interest. The sectors that we've seen tremendous deal flow in is consumer tech, is IT, and BFSI. Financial services. I think going forward, we will start to see a lot more interest when it comes to renewables. The entire theme towards ESG, I think, is for real. And you'll start to see a lot of activity when it comes to people taking stakes in terms of the renewable sectors. And I think also you will start to see a lot more deals when it comes to healthcare, which is a nascent area and it's got a huge opportunity. Which has got a positive fillip from COVID itself.
Now, a very interesting trend globally that we've seen, Karun, is that, you know, there are instances of, say, perhaps three top MNC conglomerates, and I'm talking about the likes of GE, Toshiba, Johnson & Johnson. You know, all of them are looking at breaking down, splitting up their businesses, exploring a complete rehaul of operations. Now, the Bain M&A 2021 report also refers to, you know, how there are certain changes happening in Indian conglomerates. Going ahead, how would you compare, you know, the global trend of, you know, conglomerates breaking up with what's happening back home with other, you know, with the domestic conglomerates, the likes of the Tata Group, the likes of the Adanis? Are they becoming, you know, are they looking at becoming leaner and meaner, you know, groups? Or do you really think that they could go the global way and actually split?
I think what we've seen in the last couple of years in corporate India more broadly, and of course with the conglomerates, is everyone has done belt tightening. And the amount of productivity increase people have realized and or capitalized on is very significant. And that's an important one because that's a good way to fund investments. And people are looking at profitable growth investments and strategic investments. So tightening the belt has been and has become the norm. So this is now, you know, clearly a part of the DNA for many of the conglomerates and many of, and for a lot of the successful players in corporate India. I think the trend that we picked up on was really a reshaping, an active reshaping of the portfolios within conglomerates. And I think for the first time, we are seeing a lot of divestments, of strategic divestments. And we were not seeing as much of that earlier. So we are seeing conglomerates actively manage their portfolio in terms of figuring out which ones do not make sense, where they do not have a good long-term strategic position. And then the value to somebody else is greater than the value to them. And they're using that to reinvest in their core businesses, or they're using that to reshape or enter new lines of business. So the actively managing the portfolio, the shape of the portfolio, I think it's a very interesting trend. We are also seeing this because if you go one step below, is there is also the next gen coming in that are very interested in some of the new age sectors, in the new age economies. So we are starting to see conglomerates play some pretty interesting bets when it comes to, you know, new sectors, and then take a hard look at, you know, evaluating where they currently are. So that is a very interesting and a very smart trend. And we see when we looked at you know, data on conglomerate performance, the ones who are actively reshaping their overall portfolio end up with much better returns over time. So I think the Indian conglomerates are doing exactly that. So very smart moves they're making.
Right. So clearly, status quo will not work when it comes to generating high returns to shareholders. And this is, you know, the conglomerate philosophy, so to say. And who knows, you know, we may not recognize many of these conglomerates going ahead the way we are used to recognizing them, or the way we perceive them, because many of them are evolving in several different ways. Right, Karan, last question before we wrap up. ESG, that's a dominant theme in boardrooms the world over. ESG is also a dominant theme when it comes to decision-making in deals. You know, if you have private equity funds, you know, their backers are very clear. You know, let's focus on companies with good ESG practices. Let's focus on targets with good ESG practices. And, you know, it's also become a crucial part of due diligence as far as many deals are concerned. Now, other than renewable energy, that's a clear-cut area wherein we have seen a lot of global interest. A lot of investors are putting money over there. A lot of deals are, in fact, being worked on as we speak. So that's a no-brainer of a sector. Other than renewable energy in India, which are some of the other segments where you see the ESG M&A play, M&A story play out, Karan?
I think ESG is in its very nascent stages, and this is something that is a mega trend that I think will stay with us, and we're just getting started on. And I think COP26, the rise of awareness levels are all going to fuel the adoption of and putting ESG on top of the agenda for CEOs, for boardrooms. I think renewables and the entire environment is an area that we're going to start to, we will see a lot more activity. But to answer your specific question, I can see areas of health. I can see areas of education getting massive, interest when it comes to, ESG, and also about some of the disruptions when it comes to auto. You've seen the investments that TPG Rai has put in Tata Motors in their EV business. So there are multiple areas in healthcare, for example. There is a big need for access, where there's a whole host of the missing middle that do not have access to primary care, do not have access to quality healthcare. So people who can use, provide that those levels of access, I think have a big ESG story. I think there is also a very interesting intersection here of ESG and technology. And I think what we are seeing is, those who can cross the ESG and technology, probably can take advantage of a multiplier impact when it comes to value unlock. But as we are all seeing, this is chapter one of ESG, and this is going to be an area to absolutely watch out and actively look at opportunities going forward.
Right. So many first-time buyers expect that trend to continue. Private equity funds will keep going gung-ho and look at more and more sectors for controlled deals. Conglomerates will rehaul their operations and look leaner and meaner. And of course, the big bang ESG opportunity. Karan, thanks so much for taking our time and sharing some of your key perspectives on some of the data and some of the trends that one needs to watch out for going ahead as far as deal activity in 2022 is concerned. Thank you so much for taking out time and joining us, Karan.
Very nice to chat with you, Ashwin. Thank you. Take care.